Good morning. So good to see you here today. Thank you for coming, and we're honored to have you with us. We have a couple of announcements. This is the last day of the fiscal year for White Oak. So if you would like to make some contributions to White Oak this afternoon on our online giving that would go on our fiscal year for this year, that'd be welcome to top off the year. The Lord leads you to maybe contribute something that finishes up our year. Today will be the day to do that. Mentioned a couple other things. Glad to have the Chellies here with us. I believe you all are heading back to India today. Oh, wow. We'll remember that in our prayer time. So pray for the Chellies as they return to India, their ministry there. And they split their time between India and the United States. And the Lord has really blessed that ministry. And let's pray for them as they return. Also, by way of announcement, dinner on the grounds today, yes. And it's church-wide. You say, I came today, I didn't know there was dinner on the grounds. It's okay, believe me, there will be food, plenty of it. So please join us right after the service downstairs in our fellowship hall for our 4th of July dinner, with fried chicken and so forth. We also want to mention our life groups. What we have in the, it's my mistake, what we have in the bulletin is a week off. The next life groups will really be on Sunday the 14th and Wednesday the 17th. So it's going to be the second and fourth Sundays what we do to start that. So that's my bad. I apologize for that. We'll get that corrected. It is correct on your monthly calendar. So if you have a monthly calendar, which is in your bulletin for July, you'll see that the life groups are correct in that. So I wanted to make that one correction. Let's stand and open at our singing as Warren leads us. Thank you.
Pastor Polson has been quoting Solid Rock about every other week, if you've noticed. It seems like, and I thought it's a great way to start today, patriotic weekend, political season, but it's about Christ. He's the one that lived for us, died for us, and he holds us eternally secure, and he's coming again. So let's rejoice together. We'll sing all the stanzas.
Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the freedoms we enjoy in this country, the freedom of assembly, the freedom of religion, the freedom of speech. And we thank you that you've given us even greater freedoms, boldness, and access to your very throne. We want to pray for our country. We are commanded by you to pray for those in authority, and we want to be a blessing to this city. I pray for our president, our vice president. I pray for our senators. I pray for the House of Representatives. I pray for the Supreme Court. I pray for our state and local officials as well. I beg you, Father, to uphold them, guide them, lead them. And Father, we know that even the king's heart is in your hands. And Father, we are truly thankful that we meet here today without fear, immediate fear of being arrested or harassed because of our faith. And I pray, Father, that we might propagate our faith, that we might see a more righteous nation because more people are made and declared to be righteous by the work of the power of the Holy Spirit through Jesus Christ. Now, Father, we have much to confess as a nation. Our sins are great, and they are many. I beg you to be merciful. And I pray, Father, that out of confusion and chaos, you would bring clarity as it concerns the gospel of Jesus Christ. I pray for the Chellies as they return to India. We thank you for that decades-old ministry, and I beg you, Father, to fill them with your Spirit, give them a safe trip. May they see souls saved. May they see young men trained for the ministry who are sent out to proclaim the unsearchable riches of Jesus Christ. I pray that they would have God's speed and that you would anoint them with the Holy Spirit for the task at hand. Father, we come asking that you would give us a wonderful service today. Wonderful in the sense that we get to explore the one who is wonderful, that we get to come to a place of understanding that which has not been known before because you've revealed and unfolded the mystery before us. And we, Father, thank you for Jesus Christ, the fullness of the Godhead bodily, whose mercy and grace is indeed unsearchable, boundless, unfathomable. And him we proclaim and him we serve. For our time of food fellowship afterwards, we don't take that lightly, Father. We think of it as a time of joy, a time of feasting, a time of celebration, a time of fellowship, a time of camaraderie, a time of sharing. We just praise you, Father, for giving us the ability to do this. We ask your blessing upon it. Now, Father, I pray for the preaching of your word. The entrance of your word is what gives light. Your word is not going to return to you empty. Your word is still a quick and powerful and sharp two-edged sword. I beg you, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, that the Holy Spirit would apply the word of God to every heart here, that we might know how better to walk before you in love and to love one another. Father, we commit every aspect of this service, every syllable that's sung or said, every note that is played, we commit in the name of our King of Kings and Lord of Lords, that it be done in your glory and for your praise and for your honor. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Another song of testimony. Christ lived for us and died and lives again. Let's sing. He will hold us fast.
Thank you. Let us pray. Most gracious Heavenly Father, I come to you in reverential fear, knowing that you are the Lord God Almighty, worthy of all honor and praise. You are the one and only true living God, the Alpha and the Omega, the great I Am, Prince of Peace and Lord of Lords. And I thank you that you have all knowledge and all power. And I thank you for the opportunity we have to come aside to worship you and to fellowship with each other. I ask now that you would bless the pastor as he brings a message. May it strengthen us and encourage us. And I ask your blessings upon the offering that we bring to you out of love. Pray that you would use it to spread your message here at home throughout the entire world. And I pray this prayer in Jesus' most precious name. Amen.
Our scripture reading today is Mark chapter 2, or do you want chapter 4?
Chapter 2.
Okay, chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. And when he returned to Capernaum after some days, it was reported that he was at home, and many were gathered together, so that there was no more room, not even at the door. And he was preaching the word to them. And they came, bringing to him a paralytic carried by four men. And when they could not get near him because of the crowd, they removed the roof above him. And when they had made an opening, they let down the bed on which the paralytic lay. And when Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, "Son, your sins are forgiven." Now some of the scribes were sitting there questioning in their hearts, "Why does this man speak like that? He is blaspheming. Who can forgive sins but God alone?" And immediately Jesus, perceiving in his spirit that they thus questioned within themselves, said to them, "Why do you question these things in your hearts? Which is easier, to say to the paralytic, 'Your sins are forgiven,' or to say, 'Rise up your bed and walk'? But that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins." He said to the paralytic, "I say to you, rise, pick up your bed, and go home." And he rose and immediately picked up his bed and went out before them all, so that they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, "We never saw anything like this." This is God's word.
Wonderful Jesus who does wonderful things. We're going to learn a new hymn, and Beth's going to sing the first stanza titled "Lamb of God," and then we're going to sing the second stanza and the third stanza and repeat the refrain. So let's listen and sing with our hearts and then with our voices. Beth?
Your only Son, no sin to hide, but you have sent him from your side to walk upon this ruined sod and to become the Lamb of God. O Lamb of God, sweet Lamb of God, I love this holy Lamb of God. Oh, wash me in his precious blood, my Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God. Your gift of love they crucified, they laughed and scorned him as he died. The humble king they named a fraud and sacrificed the Lamb of God. O Lamb of God, sweet Lamb of God, I love the holy Lamb of God. O wash me in his precious blood, my Jesus Christ, the Lamb. So lost I should have died, but you have brought me to your side to be led by your staff and rod and to be called the Lamb of God. O Lamb of God, sweet Lamb of God, I love the blood, my Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God. O Lamb of God, sweet Lamb of God, I love the holy Lamb of God. O wash me in his precious blood, my Jesus Christ, the Lamb.
Thank you, Warren. Thank you, orchestra, and those who participated. If you have your Bibles, please turn to the book of Ephesians, chapter 3. Ephesians chapter 3. Let's look at the first 13 verses, the first six of which we looked at temporarily last week. Ephesians 3. For this reason, I, Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, on behalf of you Gentiles, assuming that you have heard of the stewardship of God's grace that was given to me for you, how the mystery was made known to me by revelation, as I have written briefly. When you read this, you can perceive my insight into the mystery of Christ, which was not made known to the sons of men in other generations, as it has now been revealed to his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. This mystery is that the Gentiles are fellow heirs, members of the same body, and partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. Of this gospel I was made a minister according to the gift of God's grace, which was given me by the working of his power. To me, though I am the very least of all the saints, this grace was given to preach to the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to bring to light for everyone what is the plan of the mystery hidden for ages in God, who created all things, so that through the church the manifold wisdom of God might now be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. This was according to the eternal purpose that he has realized in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence through our faith in him. So I ask you not to lose heart over what I am suffering for you, which is your glory. Ruth Bell Graham, Billy Graham's wife, also a prolific writer, recalls growing up as a missionary in China. One of the stories she told was about an oil company that was going to open a new operation in China, and they wanted to find a man to manage the new division. They wanted someone young, they wanted someone who was a university graduate, they wanted someone who could speak the language fluently. And they found someone, at least they thought they did. He was a 28-year-old missionary who was already living in the city where the company was planning to establish the office. And when someone asked how much salary this young man was currently obtaining because of this missionary work, they realized it was not a whole lot. They wanted to hire him away, so to speak. So the oil company offered the young missionary 10 times his current salary. He refused. They raised that offer. He refused it. They offered him even more. He declined again. Finally, the agent asked, "What will you take?" His response is, "It's not a question of salary. The salary is tremendous. The trouble is with the job. The job is too little. I feel that God has called me to preach the gospel of Christ. I would be a fool to quit preaching in order to sell oil." Such were the giants, Graham said, among whom we grew up on the mission field. Let me hasten to say, there's nothing wrong with selling oil. There's nothing wrong with selling cars. There's nothing wrong with entering into the kinds of professions that many of you have entered into. But by comparison, what each of us is asked to do, proclaim the unsearchable riches of Christ to a lost generation, makes those occupations in some ways pale in comparison. Paul is evidence of what seems to be an amazingly divine sense of humor. Now, I don't know if God has a sense of humor. We often say that he does. I don't know if the Bible really says that. It does say God laughs, and sometimes I wonder if I'm laughing at the same things he laughs at, or vice versa. But he's certainly not above the ironic. He's certainly not above of turning things on their head. So when you think about it, this is the Apostle Paul, formerly known as Saul of Tarsus. This man, at his conversion, probably hated Gentiles and Jesus more than any other person on the planet. to the point where he dedicated his life to their persecution and the squelching of that name, Jesus Christ. And then God comes along through Jesus Christ on the road to Damascus and literally arrests him, stops him in his tracks, blinds him temporarily, and says, I'm calling you. And I'm going to call you to the Gentiles, and I'm also going to show you the things you're going to suffer for my sake. And then the rest of the book of Acts, most of the book of Acts, and throughout numerous epistles in the New Testament, we see enacted that life. A life completely transformed by the power of God, and a life completely turned on its head so that the man who hated Gentiles now lovingly proclaims the gospel to Gentiles. And the man who hated Jesus Christ now preaches in his name and in the power of his Holy Spirit. God does the amazing. And in this case, you have a most unlikely minister who's been asked to basically unfold an amazing mystery, an unknowable mystery. He's been asked to, along with us, to proclaim unsearchable riches, things that can't be known, depths that can't be plumbed, are now part and parcel of the ministry that each of us has. Now, let me hasten to say, God has not called each of you to be an apostle. God has not called you to do what I'm doing today. That's fine. I have not been called to what you've been asked to do. And we're not making a huge distinction between the secular and the sacred. You can sell oil for the glory of God. But in comparison to what you've also been asked to do, you hope that that selling of oil becomes, no pun intended, a platform. A platform for you to do something even more monumental and even greater. And that is introduce people to our unsearchably rich Christ. Introduce people, Gentiles included, to know that which has previously been unknowable, that they, Jew, Gentile alike, are being formed into a new race, and that through faith in Jesus Christ, you could become a part of that, and now your life not only has meaning, it has ultimate meaning. And your life is on display in the heavenly realms, astounding angels. Let's talk about Paul, this proclaimer of the ministry. As we said last week, for this reason, I, Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus on your behalf, on the behalf of you Gentiles, and you have a dash in some translations. He picks that thought back up in verse 14. So basically, he's starting a prayer for the Ephesians to understand what he's already proclaimed in chapters 1 and 2. He wants them to see it with spiritual eyes. But Paul, being Paul, digresses. And the Holy Spirit has him stop what he's doing there and go on to tell us something else. Verse 2, assuming that you have heard of the stewardship, administration, if you will, of God's grace that was given to me for you. So basically, what is Paul saying? He is a proclaimer of the ministry. He's a proclaimer of the ministry that God has already established. He petitions, he prays for God's people, but he also describes himself as a prisoner. But notice, he's a prisoner of Jesus Christ. He's not a prisoner of the Roman Empire, though he writes these words most likely from a Roman prison or at least under house arrest in Rome. Paul says, I am a prisoner, but I am being held captive not by the Romans. I'm not being held captive by the Jews. I'm being held captive by Jesus Christ. Now, we don't think positively about terms like captive. We think of it in a negative sense. Someone was taken hostage. Someone was captured. Perhaps we think of it positively if some notorious criminal has been captivated. But the concept here for Paul is, I know who I am. I am a servant, a slave, a minister of Jesus Christ who actually holds me captive. And don't think of it in the negative sense of having no will or no freedom. It's in the positive sense of having ultimate freedom, an ultimate expression of a new will created in Christ Jesus. My thoughts are captivated by Christ. My heart has been captivated by Christ. And this is why I bring every thought into the captivity of Christ. He's a prisoner. He's a petitioner. Now notice, he's in prison for Christ, a prisoner of Christ, not of Rome. He's a prisoner on behalf of the Gentiles. And we talked about this last week. The reason he's in jail is because he is taking the gospel to the Gentiles and the Judaizers can't stand it. And what the Judaizers can't stand, as we talked about, is the openness of this mystery that has been declared by God himself, that people come to God without becoming Jewish, and that Gentiles have the full, unadulterated rights and privileges of citizenship in God's kingdom and membership in God's family. And when Paul, under the authority of the Holy Spirit and in the power of the Holy Spirit, proclaims that message, it results in him getting thrown in jail. His circumstances were divinely appointed. What does he tell the Philippians in chapter 1, verse 12? I want you to know, brothers, that what has happened to me has really served to advance the gospel. Paul's writing from the same prison cell, no doubt. The Philippians had sent him some provisions. He was thanking them for that. But he says, I want to comfort you with this. The things that I'm suffering right now, including jail, have happened to advance the gospel. That's why they happened. So that it has become known throughout the whole imperial guard and to all the rest that my imprisonment is for Christ. The imperial guard, we're talking about those groups of people who actually guarded Caesar's household, a part of Caesar's private army, if you will. That group of people now knows why I'm in jail. They know I'm in jail because my imprisonment is for Christ. Verse 14, Philippians 1. And most of the brothers, having become confident in the Lord by my imprisonment, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. My imprisonment has actually emboldened other people to also proclaim the word. They look and say, wow, Paul's really suffering for Christ. I can too. If Paul's willing to go to jail for the gospel, okay, that's something to live for. I'll go to jail for the gospel if I have to. I'm going to preach boldly like Paul did. Now he goes on to say, some indeed preach Christ from envy and rivalry. There probably is still some Jewish Christians who are preaching. They're still not getting it. They're bordering on being Judaizers. Maybe they're doing it for their own initiative. But he says there are others who from goodwill preach the gospel. He says, I don't care. The latter do it out of love, knowing that I am put here for the defense of the gospel. The former proclaim Christ out of selfish ambition, not sincerely, but thinking to afflict me in my imprisonment. What then, he says, only that in every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is proclaimed. And in that I rejoice, yes, and I will rejoice. Why? For I know that through your prayers and the help of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, that this will turn out for my deliverance. Maybe not my physical deliverance, but certainly my ultimate deliverance. And it is my eager expectation and hope that I will not be at all ashamed, but that with full courage, now as always, Christ will be honored in my body, whether by life or by death. Then the famous phrase, for to me to live, say it with me, is Christ, and to die is gain. Is that your response to the circumstances that you find yourself in this day? The last day of June, 2024. Do you look upon the divinely ordained circumstances of life as an opportunity to know Christ better and to proclaim him more clearly? Or are you prone, like me, to have a ongoing pity party for the things that aren't really going that well, along with an ongoing happy party when things are pretty nice? Folks, this is what Paul could say. I have learned in whatever state, in whatever circumstances I find myself, therewith to be content. Why? Because the circumstances are divinely ordained for my personal growth in Christ and for the proclamation of the gospel to someone who needs it. You are where you are today, divinely circumstanced, because God wants you to use those circumstances to bring glory to him. So Paul's this proclaimer. He reveals God's message. What message? He's talking about a mystery. We looked at this last week. A mystery is something that has not been made known until it is divinely made known. It cannot be known by human means. It has to be revealed through supernatural means. So Paul is saying, God has given me a stewardship, an administration. I am his steward, entrusted with, on basis of God's grace, that which was given to me. And what was given to him was this mystery. It is a gracious proclamation that the Jews and Gentiles are being formed into one new race. And he says, I have this as a stewardship. And I'm just still amazed that Paul is the one God chose. But then as I stand before you, I stand amazed that I am the one God has chosen to even preach this message. He's Christ's steward, and he's been entrusted with the gospel of grace, the gracious gospel, the gracious message. And he understands God's message because he was taught directly by Jesus Christ himself. It was made known to him by revelation, just as it was made known to Peter and John by revelation from Christ. And again, this mystery is not that Gentiles will be saved. The Old Testament makes that clear, that Abraham, and Abraham, all the nations of the earth will be blessed. And that when the Messiah comes, the Gentiles are going to be blessed. They got that. The mystery is that you now can come to Christ as a Gentile without having to become a Jew. You can come as you are, just as you are, we sing, without having to go through Jewish rites, without having to be declared somehow a Jewish proselyte. You can come to Christ directly, Jew or Gentile, because by the same grace and the same faith, he's making you both part of the same family, a new race of people called the church. That's what drove the Judaizers nuts, and that's why they followed him around and caused him so much grief. But let's talk about this concept of Paul being placed in the ministry. He's now revealed this, the mystery of the Gentiles, and in verse 7 he says, of this gospel, I was made a minister, a servant, according to the gift of God's grace, which was given me by the working of his power. I'm doing what I'm doing because God has made me a minister according to the gift of his grace. And when you think about gift of God's grace, it's almost redundant. It's almost like gift of God's gift, grace of God's grace. It's the same basic word. I have been graced. I have been gifted to do this. His ministry was based on God's grace, and his ministry was empowered by God's greatness. I am doing this by the working of his power, specifically through the Holy Spirit. This is why Paul in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 9 says, for I am the least of the apostles, unworthy to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace toward me was not in vain, not empty. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Paul says, I'm the least of the apostles. I know that. I persecuted the church. I was horrible. But isn't God's grace amazing? He turned that hall around, and as a result of his empowerment, I was able to actually outwork them in a sense. Then I realized it's not me outworking them, it's God in me working to a great extent. And this naturally led to Paul being humbled. What does he say? To me, verse 8, though I am the very least of all the saints, this was given. You know, Paul said he's the least of the apostles. He also said in 1 Timothy 1:15, this is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. He says, I'm the least of the apostles, I'm the greatest sinner in the world. That's the humility that God sent to Paul. One pastor, Ray Stedman, the late Ray Stedman, put it like this. I think it was very helpful. I've heard people say, as they have read some of Paul's writings, this man is an egoist. He talks about his holiness and his faithfulness and his tenderness and compassion. He says, be imitators of me, even as I am of Christ. And they're amazed at what they think to be the conceit of the Apostle Paul. But if you really want to know what he thought of himself, here it is. In fact, you can detect a gradual change of the apostle's idea of himself. In the 1 Corinthian letter, which was written earlier than this, he says, "I am the least of all the apostles." That's only last in a list of 13. Here he says, "I am the least of all the saints." In fact, he invents a word here, puts the comparative and the superlative together. "I am less than the least of all the saints." That estimation is quite a bit lower, but when he wrote 2 Timothy, his last letter, he said, "I am the chief of sinners." And as Pastor Stebbins says, now that is progress. Okay, he's going in the right direction. That's progress. I've come, as I've gotten older in the ministry, I know I'm the least of the apostles. I'm less than the least of all the saints. Let's get it straight. I'm the worst. And what's that all about? Is it just false humility? No. It's a humility based on an understanding of how he has been saved and how much Jesus Christ had to do to save him. When people really come to grips with the level of their sin, their sinfulness, and their rebellion against a holy God, and they come to grips with the fact that God in Christ saved them from that rebellion, the more they contemplate that, the less they think of themselves and the more they think of Christ. That's what happened in Paul's life. Spurgeon had a similar testimony. When he was 18 years old, he was really seeking God's will. He's already been preaching. He thought, I need some more theological training. So both his friends and his father advised him to attend college to go on for further training. So he made an application to Regent's Park College, and he had an interview set up with the head of the college. And that interview was supposed to take place at the home of a Mr. McMillan, the famous publisher, McMillan. So Spurgeon gets up early in the morning, he prays, asks the Lord for guidance. At the appointed time, he shows up at McMillan's house, he rings the bell, the servant comes, shows him where the parlor is, asks him to take a seat, and he sat there for 2 hours. And finally, his patience kind of wore out, and he's kind of figured out what's going on. He called the servant and was horrified to learn that she had forgotten to tell the dean that he was there. The dean got equally frustrated and he left. He totally missed the appointment for acceptance into Regent's College. So he was tired, he was exhausted. He left Cambridge, went back to London by train, and the interview never took place. He was deeply disturbed at first. And his first impulse was to run after the man, to chase him all over, try to find him. But when he got back home, he took a long walk in the country to kind of calm down. And his testimony is, a verse came to him almost audibly. Jeremiah 45:5. "Seekest thou great things for thyself? Seek them not." The Lord seemed to be telling him, I don't want you to worry about this circumstance. I want you to worry about preaching the gospel. I can make it up to you, in a sense. As a result, he never did make it to college. But in a way, it didn't matter. He became the most powerful and successful and fruitful ministry in the history of Victorian England. He later said that he had 1,000 times thanked the Lord very heartily for the strange providence which forced his steps into another and far better path. Now, my message here is, if you're in seminary, don't quit. That's not the point. Or, I don't think I need college education. You probably do. The point is, God overrules and God dictates the circumstances of your life that best prepare you for the furtherance of His gospel. And your story is a part of a great story, and your story doesn't have to be just like everybody else's story. Let God lead. Let God show you what He wants you to do. And if your desire is that Christ be made known, that the unsearchable riches of Christ be declared, God will guide through those circumstances and give you a pleasurable opportunity to perform His work. That's what's been true of my life. And that leads to the performance of this ministry. Let's look at verses 8 and following. He says, "This grace was given to preach to the Gentiles the unsearchable, it could be translated unfathomable, riches of Christ. The concept of unsearchable or unfathomable means they are without the ability to be measured. The depth is too great to be measured. The breadth is too great to be measured. It's unmeasurable. It's unsearchable. It's past finding out, as the King James says. So what is he supposed to be doing here? He's supposed to be expounding that which is unsearchable. Well, that sounds like fun. Okay. No one can know the end of it, but I want you to preach it anyway. And this message of unsearchable grace and unsearchable riches is primarily preached to people who didn't even know they needed it, the Gentiles. He's to proclaim primarily to the Gentiles these unsearchable riches of Christ. And he's supposed to bring to light for everyone what is the plan of the mystery hidden for ages by God. So he has a ministry of seeking to preach that which is unsearchable and to unfold that which is unknowable. And that's what every gospel preacher does. It's what every gospel proclaimer does. You're preaching that which is unsearchable, and you're unfolding that which could not be known apart from when God made it known. Jesus is unsearchable, folks. His riches are unfathomable. I mean, he's called the fullness of God. The fullness of the Godhead bodily dwells in him. He's the repository of all riches. He's the Pacific Ocean of all grace. He's the universe of all mercy. You cannot in a lifetime of preaching ever adequately cover how rich the mercies and love of Christ are. He's better. We saw that in our study of Hebrews, did we not? He's better than Adam. He's better than Abel. He's better than Abraham. He's better than Moses. He's better than the angels. He's better than Jacob. He's better than Joseph. He's better than anybody. He's just better. He's supreme. He's glorious. And that's the one we talk about. That's the one we proclaim. Let me ask you, as I ask myself sometimes, do you give adequate thought to who Jesus is and what he's like? Or is he still this guy with some pretty long hair and long beard on a flannel board to you? Who is Jesus Christ? And you cannot plumb his depths, but have you plunged in to try? Can you swim a little deeper? Can you go a little further? And I'm not talking about having deep, bodacious thoughts that just put you in a trance. I'm talking about sitting down with the Word of God open in your lap or in front of you on your computer and just say, Lord, show me more about Jesus. You've told me that his mercies and his grace and his character are unsearchable, but can you help me search it out? And after a lifetime of that kind of prayer and a lifetime of that kind of study, people will know that you have been with Jesus in the same way they knew that Peter and John had been with Jesus. And to explain this unknowable way of God to the Gentiles, you Gentiles can have a part in God himself. You can be a part of his kingdom. You can be a member of his family. And it's also the same words we see in verse 6, that you have kind of a co-prefix here. The Gentiles are fellow heirs, co-heirs. We have same body. We have partakers, same participation in Christ through the gospel. And that shows us that this gospel is for everybody. If the gospel is for the Jews, and it is, and the gospel is for the Gentiles, then we're left with only aliens or Martians or something, and they don't exist. But I mean, if you're talking about on this earth, you've got two categories, Jew, Gentile, that's it. And those two categories now become one thing, the Church of Jesus Christ. But what's Paul's purpose in all this? Verses 10 and 12 give us this. So that through the church, now listen, put your old thinking caps on here. Listen with me. What's going on here? What is this plan of the mystery hidden for ages? What's really at the core of this mystery? Here it is. Hidden for ages in God who created all things, so that through the church, the manifold wisdom of God might now be made known to the rulers and authorities in heavenly places. Now, are you getting this? Let's read it again. Okay, elementary class, got your thinking caps on, whatever else your elementary teacher said, got your brain in gear. Think about this phrase. So that through the church, on the basis of and through the administration of the church, the manifold, the word manifold, we sometimes think of variegated. It's the idea of multicolored. It's like a rainbow, multi-hued. It has the concept of complexity. The multifaceted wisdom of God might now be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. He's talking about the heavenly realm. He's talking about that place in the heavenlies where both demons operate, Satan operates, and God's angelic beings operate. He's talking, I think, not just about the negative ones, but the positive ones. The angelic beings, the hosts of heaven. He's saying there's something being revealed to them that they had no knowledge of, and they stand in amazement of. This is what the angels look at and ponder. They wonder, what is this? That through the church, God's manifold wisdom is now made known to all these people. What's that all about? God's wisdom has announced by the church. I like how Albert Barnes puts this. One grand purpose in the creation of the universe was that the wisdom of God might be clearly shown by the church. It was not enough to evidence it by the formation of the sun, the stars, the earth, the seas, the mountains, the floods. It was not enough to show it by the creation of intelligent beings, the formation of immortal minds on earth, and the various ranks in the angelic world. There were views of the divine character which could be obtained only in connection with the redemption of the world. There were things about God that no one's going to understand until he saves folks. Barnes goes on, hence the universe was created and man was made upon the earth, not merely to illustrate the divine perfections in the work of creation, but in a still more illustrious manner in the work of redemption. Folks, God is holding you up in front of the entire angelic world. And he says, this is how wise I am. And beyond that, when God's people in this nasty now and now walk in wisdom, walk in perfected holiness through the power of the Holy Spirit, walk in a way that shows they have been with Jesus, your daily, godly, Spirit-filled, Spirit-led, Word-informed walk astounds not only your neighbors, it actually has the angelic beings of heaven saying in a profound way, who'da thunk it? Who'da thunk up that? And we must be in the presence of an incredibly wise God whose wisdom is unfathomable, and I know it must be true because I'm gazing on his work, the redeemed people of God. Poof! As the kids would say, poof! If that doesn't blow your mind, nothing blows your mind. If this doesn't blow your mind, do you have a mind? I mean, this is astounding. And think about it. How could it possibly have been made known if God did not make it known? And you say to yourself, oh boy, when the angels look at me, they're like sniggering behind their wings, like, get a load of that guy. No. No. They are seeing someone transformed by the grace of the living God. and they're seeing God take that which was at enmity and making it one. He's taking Jew and Gentile who hated each other and despised each other, and he's placed them in the same body. And he's taken people of every tongue, tribe, nation, and he's put them all together, and he's formed a brand new race, and that race is called the church, and that church is filled with the Spirit, and that church is the dwelling place of God, and that church proclaims the glories of Christ. And I look at this church and I say, I can't believe what I'm seeing. This is a wise God, an all-wise God who could have ever come up with this. Don't gloss this stuff, folks. Don't read over it and say, I wonder what Paul's thinking about that. Think about what Paul's saying. He goes on to say, this was according to the eternal purpose that he realized in Christ Jesus our Lord. The whole thing came together through Christ. And this is why Christ's return is the consummation of the age and the redemption of all created things. John Stott says, it is as if a great drama is being enacted. History is the theater, the world is the stage, and church members in every land are the actors. God himself has written the play, and he directs and produces it. Act by act, scene by scene, the story continues to unfold. But who are the audience? They are the cosmic intelligences, the principalities and powers in the heavenly places. We are to think of them as spectators of the drama of salvation. Thus, the history of the Christian church becomes a graduate school for the angels. God's wisdom is essentially an infinite rainbow of God's grace. And this work is accomplished in Christ. God does the work through his Son, empowered by the Holy Spirit. And what does that teach us? Stop striving, folks. Oh, Paul worked hard. But when it comes to sanctification and redemption, Jesus Christ has been made for us wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and redemption. It's already been done. And this is why Paul puts all those great terms, even the term glorified, in the past tense. It has been done in Christ. Finished. Complete. I don't feel like, I know it's the nasty now and now. I know we dwell in that already, but not yet. But brothers and sisters in Christ, we are progressing if we have the Spirit of God. We are growing if we have the Spirit of God. We are being daily transformed into his image if we have the Spirit of God. And we are becoming more like Christ every day because of the Spirit of God. You've all seen older couples. I guess I qualify as being part of an older couple. And sometimes you have older couples and they're still the exact opposites. And there's sometimes you have older couples and you see pictures of them and it's like they start looking like each other. They just keep dwelling with that person and it's like you can't think of one without the other. And they're almost like yin and yang. They're two sides of a coin. And what's that been? It's people dwelling together in love for decades, and they become like each other, and they finish each other's sentences, and they glory in the same things. In a much more exalted and spiritual state, that's what it is for us. We're progressing daily to become more like Jesus Christ so that his thoughts are our thoughts, his likes are our likes, the things he hates, we hate, the things he loves, we love. And God does the work. Oh, folks, give up the striving. I was reading about Hudson Taylor of China. He was working, worrying so frantically. His health was about to break. His friends were just fearing for his very life. He was close to a breakdown. And he gets this letter from a fellow missionary named John McCarthy. Maybe you've never heard of John McCarthy. I had not. And this John McCarthy told of a discovery that he had made from John 15. He's writing a letter to his friend Taylor. And this discovery was the joy of abiding in Christ. McCarthy's letter said this: abiding, not striving or struggling, looking off unto him, trusting him for present power. That is not new, and yet 'tis new to me. Christ literally all seems to me now the power, the only power for service, the only ground for unchanging joy. Taylor said that as he read this letter at his mission station on Saturday, September 4th, 1869, his own eyes were opened. As I read, he recalled, I saw it all. I looked to Jesus, and when I saw, oh, how the joy flowed. He wrote to his sister in England and said, As to work, mine was never so plentiful, so responsible, or so difficult, but the weight and strain are all gone. The last month or more has been perhaps the happiest of my life, and I long to tell you a little of what the Lord has done for my soul. What had the Lord done for my soul? When the agony of soul was at its height, a sentence in the letter from dear McCarthy was used to remove the scales from my eyes, and the Spirit of God revealed the truth of our oneness with Jesus as I had never known it before. McCarthy, who had been much exercised by the same sense of failure, but saw the light before I did, wrote, I quote from memory, but how to get faith strengthened? Not by striving after faith, but by resting on the faithful one. As I read, I saw it all. As I thought of the vine and the branches, what light the blessed Spirit poured into my soul. That's what Paul got. And this is why he could be genuinely joyous and productive while in chains. Because he knew he was vitally connected to Jesus Christ. He was united with Christ. Folks, give up your striving. I beg you in Jesus' name. Let's stop this. Oh, we work. We work hard. But we work as if it all depended upon us rather than working because God has already completed it. And notice what you get with this. Verse 12, look at this. You can tell this book amazes me. I hope it amazes you. It's according to his eternal plan that he realized in Christ. Verse 12, in whom, Jesus Christ, we have boldness and access with confidence through our faith. And that boldness could be translated freedom of speech. We have the ability to speak to God himself, and we have the ability to speak to God himself in his very throne room. We go to heaven, and we have the boldness to appear before the God of heaven and say, my Father, you're in heaven. Holy be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And I ask him for my daily bread, and I ask him for my daily sustenance, and I ask to be empowered by the Holy Spirit. And I ask him about things that are going on in my life. And I ask him questions, as the psalmist asks questions. And I talk to my heavenly Father with boldness and with access. Oh, I do it on my knees. I do it in humility. I know I'm talking to the God of glory. But I talk to the God of glory as my heavenly, say it with me, Father. Say it again, Father. Boldness, access with confidence. That's why the writer of Hebrews says in chapter 4, since then we have a great high priest who's passed through the heavens, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect was tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace. It's a throne of grace. That we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. And isn't this a privilege? I ask you not to lose heart over what I am suffering for you. Don't worry about me in prison. Don't worry about the beatings. Don't worry about the shipwrecks. Don't worry about the chains. That's all okay. I'm really doing fine because I know who brought this about and I know why he brought it, because he wants me to keep on declaring the unsearchable riches of Jesus Christ, and he wants me to keep on unfolding that great mystery of the ages, and he wants me to tell Gentiles, hey, Jesus Christ can save you and unite you with himself, and you can become a member of God's household. And then you too can go to your heavenly Father with boldness because you have access through faith in him. What makes you lose heart? Might be different from some of you. Probably different from what causes me to sometimes lose heart. What causes you to say, "Oh, I just don't think I can do another day"? Conversely, what gives you comfort? What gives you joy? What prompts peace in your soul? I hope this passage of Scripture shows you what it should be. Your position in the household of God by faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. A position that's so secure that God describes you as being literally united with His Son. And that all things Christ has, you have. Because you are an heir with Christ, a joint heir with the one who saved you. That provides comfort, folks. That provides comfort. I know some of you are going through some, humanly speaking, pretty deep waters. And you're going through some things that, humanly speaking, are pretty scary. And you're going through some things that could be potentially very discouraging. But I beg you, like Hudson Taylor and Charles Spurgeon and Paul himself, don't lose heart. Consider those circumstances as divine appointments for you to better proclaim who He is to a world who needs Him so desperately. Let's pray. Your character, Father, is unsearchable, and so is your Son, Jesus Christ. And your plan would not have been knowable if you hadn't unfolded it. And the mystery is great, but we love it. And Father, you have created a grand cosmic story, and you've put the church right in the middle. And you've told each of us that we are living stones and that we're being built up together as a dwelling place for God. And the angels and the demons and the principalities and the powers now see a wisdom of God they could not see merely by creation. And with some kind of angelic utterance, they say, "Who'd have thunk it? Who could have come up with this?" We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand, please. We sing, and we dismiss for our meal. Thank you all for being here. One more invitation to all of our guests. Please join us for the meal downstairs. We'd love to have you. It doesn't matter if you didn't bring anything. That's okay. You can take something with you. We're going to have plenty. And it's going to be a good time of fellowship. I hope you can all join us. And I'm honored that you're here. You have other options. You didn't have to be here, but you knew you were a child of God and you wanted to be with other children of God. And I praise God for that. May the Lord bless you this week. And may the Lord give you great guidance and great clarity. And that's my prayer for you. God bless you all.